she and the family all well. Yeah? A bit loud? Or is it? Yeah. Is this a bit loud? Because I can actually hear myself and it's not good. That's smashing. Okay. Those in the foyer. Can anybody hear that? Yeah? Yeah. Those in the foyer, like to make your way in and we'll start our meeting. Well, welcome everybody to our family church, and you're going to say, I recognize that face, he was up here last week. Yeah, well, apparently I need the practice, so that's it. Welcome, you know, if you're visiting, welcome to book your name as a friend. We'll get introductions later, and we trust that the Lord will bless your time with us. And those who are here, and Cheryl's mum, welcome. And the Leslie family, all good, all fit. That's excellent. That's amazing. Good, yeah. And welcome, of course, to our speaker, Johnny. Okay, we look forward to what you're going to share with us, and trust that the Lord will bless you, as he will bless us from what you have to say. Johnny's going to come up later on and share what's going on there at Hope Church in Hoylake. So we look forward to that. And then he's going to share from Colossians. We have some sad news. As you, or most of you, will know via the emails, that Nigel Leslie was called home very suddenly on Tuesday. He's been a member of this church for, I don't know, many, many years. I know he was one of my Sunday school pupils back in the day. We trust that the Lord will bless Christine, comfort her, Wilf and Lorna as well at this really sad time. And we trust that the rest of his brothers and nephews and sister-in-law, they will also be comforted by the Lord. Any details about Nigel's funeral will be passed on to you as soon as we get them. Should we pray and ask the Lord to bless our time together and also to remember Nigel's family? Our Father God, we would thank you that we find ourselves here in your presence. We thank you, Lord, that we come together regularly on a Sunday, Lord, a day that was set aside by the early church for meeting together. And we ask you, Father God, that you will bless our time, Lord, as we sing your praises, we come and worship, and listen to what Johnny has to say, Lord, and that your Holy Spirit will speak through him to us, Lord, as individuals and as a church. We also pray, Father God, for those who are mourning at this time. Lord, perhaps still in a state of shock, we ask you, Father, that you will bless them. Christine especially, Lord, as she has lost her partner, her husband. We ask you, Father God, that by your Holy Spirit, Lord, you will put your arms around them, Lord, and you will comfort them at this time. We ask you this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'm going to ask the music group to come up and share a hymn with us. Thanks. And then after the hymn, will Johnny come up and share what's going on at Hope? That's great.
Thank you.
Sunday school, the Sunday class. Yeah? Okay? Thank you.
And it's so great, so great to be with you this morning. And John kind of sprung it on me as I came in. Could I do a bit of an update on things? And so just a quick way of an update, if you don't know me, my name is Johnny Brennan. I had the privilege and honour, really, 12 years ago of being part of this church. 12 years ago, I know, because I got married 12 years ago, and I remembered that one. So 12 years ago. And even before that, as a youth worker here for a little bit and various things. And so, yeah, 12 years. This is our family now. There's me, Bex, as Becca, as some of you might know her, Becca Parkinson, and our two kids, Martha and Dan, who are, Martha's 9 and Dan is 5. We've reached that weird stage with Martha of looking around secondary schools now, and it makes me feel very old. In fact, Martha said to me the other day, Daddy, do you know you're going a bit grey? Why are you going a bit grey? And I refrained from saying it was because of her. But yeah, this is the family of 4 now, so me and Bex have been married for 12 years. 12 years ago, we left Bethany as we got married and went to help replant, I guess, a church in Hoylake called Hoylake Chapel at that time. And so over 12 years of being there, things have changed a little bit. I started there just as a congregant, leading some worship and helping with some youth work. I was working for Youth for Christ at the time. And then in 2015, they put out a role for a youth and children's pastor. And through one way or another, we decided that was the right thing for us to do. So I applied, I got the job, I started working there in 2015 as Martha was born. So I've been working there just under, just over 9 years now. And it's been amazing. In 2019, my predecessor, Buddy, stepped away and went to do something else. And so they foolishly, I think, came up to me of the March of 2019 and said, will you become the pastor? And so I said, you sure? And then we did it, and I'd never led a church at this point. So we had a great 6 months. It was amazing. 2019 was brilliant, and then 2020, that little thing that happened that changed all of our lives forever. 2020 happened, and it's been a wild ride since then. I've just come off sabbatical, so this next photo here is just of us coming back from sabbatical. Hopefully it'll come up in a second. In 2019, when I took the church, I've been a pastor for 5 years, been working for the church for nearly 10 years. I said to our church about 18 months ago, if I have another 5 years, like the past 5 years that I've had, I'm going to end up quitting because I can't cope with this anymore. I don't know, just as a way of encouragement, pray for your leaders here. Leading a church is heavy. It's hard. It's dealing with people all the time, and people suck at times. They're amazing at other times, but the weight and the heaviness we had, leadership stuff, we had bereavements, we had COVID, we had so many things happen. And so I said, if I have another 5 years, like the last 5 years, I have no idea if I'm going to be able to stay in it. And I want to be a pastor as long as God calls me to be a pastor. So can I have 3 months off, fully paid, to go and figure out how to be a pastor for the long haul, to how to lead a church for the long haul? And so they said yes. And so May to July this year, I spent some time, I came away from Hope Church completely. The rest of the family stayed, because I said to Bex and the kids, I was like, we've got an opportunity, we've got 3 months, should we go to a different church? And my daughter, in fact, they're not here today, because my daughter said, I'm not missing church. I'm not going to Hope Church, which is like the best reason not to come to another church. But they said they weren't leaving. And so Bex, Dan, and Martha, they all stayed at Hope Church. I went to Long Lane in Liverpool for 3 months. Nick's my mentor. I believe he's on your weekend away next week. You are going to be blessed beyond measure, I'm sure. But Nick and the guys looked after me over there, and I just went and be part of a church for 3 months. The rest of the time, I read a lot of books in coffee shops. I picked the kids up a lot more from school. I visited different places in the country and asked pastors and leaders, and it was just the most amazing time for just spiritual renewal, really, for me as a person, as a leader. I got bored about 2 months in. I realized I need something in my life to do, which is amazing. And so, the church is is amazing. I love Hope Church, as it's now called. We changed the name in 2017. Hope Church is it looks like a cathedral in Hoylake. It's not. It's a non-denominational church filled with different types of people. I did a talk last week in our church about the intergenerational style of our church, and I see this as I look out here. The church is at its best when it has generationals all the way through, from the youngest to the oldest. We worked out our youngest is 12 weeks old, and our oldest is 94, although I wasn't allowed to say it on stage, but I can say it here because they're not watching. And in between, we've got families. The average age of our church is 45, which is an amazing thing, and books the national trend in so many ways. And so we are, as a church, we are looking to do so much more. We're trying to employ a youth and children's pastor, as I believe you guys are. We have like lots and lots of kids on a Sunday morning. We have lots and lots of opportunities in local schools to be in those schools as a presence. And as a church, we're just looking for more and more opportunities to speak into our local community, to be part of our local community. Christmas, we've just announced we've got loads of plans for Christmas. We're running a Christmas market. We're doing lots of different things. And so it really is a crazy time because we have lots of people, which is a really nice problem to have. But it is really amazing, and I'm really grateful for the years I spent here and the people who have invested in me over the years. And so, yeah, please do keep praying for us. We have got some great plans and great opportunities. But that is Hope Church in a nutshell. Lots and lots going on and lots to do. And yeah, everything's going there smoothly. I've watched the live stream already, so I know that everything's going smoothly there, which is amazing. But thanks for your prayers.
Thanks for that, Johnny. It's good to see, you know, what he started out as a youth worker here and has gone on to bigger and better things. But I don't envy your responsibilities there, mate. I know it's a lot, and there's 5-6 of us here. I bring the notices to you, if I may. First of all, the October What's On is in the foyer. Okay, so pick that one up, please, and read it and pray for the works that are going on. And so for the rest of the week, tomorrow evening we have our cheese and biscuits, where we're looking at discussing Hebrews chapters 6, 7, and 8, I think it is. But anyway, one of those chapters is, can the Christian lose the faith? And some people say yes, some people say no. Other people say we're not sure, and it could be an interesting evening, you know. Bring your boxing gloves. Alan Garner's going to lead that, by the way, and if nothing else, we have a brilliant time of fellowship, and it is a blessed time. Tuesday, the music group meet to go through the music, and then on Wednesdays, Mums and Tots, 10 till 12. And Thursday is our friendship group, again, 10 till 12 there, and all are welcome to that. On Friday, most of us are away at our church weekend, and hasn't that time come around quick, folks? And if you've not picked up your information pack, I was going to say see Carol Kendrick, but apparently you've all been good and you've collared her, and all the packs are all gone now, yeah? That's it. It's good to see Carol nod. She's not gone to sleep yet. Anyway, thanks for that, and thanks for all the hard work in putting those together, the ladies that are organising this. So for next Sunday, will there be family church here at Bethany, and the speaker expected is Peter McGrath. So, you know, for those of you who are not going to make it along to our weekend, please come back here to Bethany. Yeah, I'm sure that the Lord will bless you when you do arrive. Let's pray for those who are grieving, as I announced first thing in the meeting. Let's pray for Nigel's family, his wife Christine, the mum and dad Wilf and Lorna, and his brothers Andy, David and Christopher at this time. You know, it's good to know that Nigel was a Christian, and as Christians we know that he's at home with the Lord, but you know, it was a sudden shock that he that the Lord called him. So let's continue to pray for the family there. And any details regarding funerals, etc., we will pass on to you as soon as we know about them. Continue to pray for Brian Chilala. He's still in Arrow Park Hospital and is awaiting further tests. So continue to remember Cheryl and the family there at this time. And for your diaries, should be a rustle of paper, pens, clicking, yeah? 3rd of October, on Thursday, 3rd of October, Alpha starts here at 6:30 for a meal at 6:45. There's a sign-up list in the foyer over by the photocopier there. Have a look at it. There's booklets there to tell you a little bit about Alpha. If you've done one before and you want to do it again, that will be a blessing. If you've not done one and you think, I might like that, then please sign up and come along to that. Then on Wednesday the 9th of October, we have a church meeting. This is in the What's On for October, 7:30. So members are encouraged to attend that if they can. Then on Sunday the 20th, we have a baptism. And if you're thinking of being baptized or you have any questions about baptism, see me or any of the other elders about that. And we trust that, you know, that the Lord will bless and Nell Ost is the one that's going to be baptized. So, you know, pray for her as she takes this step in the Lord's command. Then on Tuesday the 26th of October, we're holding a quiz night and a hot pot supper. If you're no good at quizzes, come along for the hot pot supper. You know, happy days. It's a win-win. A time of fellowship there, and we trust that the Lord will bless those notices. And also, one further notice. Last week, Priscilla came up and she shared with us about the gospel choir she's involved in at Warwick University. And she sort of said, you know, if you want to know more about it, leave your details and she'll put a letter out or email you. And also she asked for prayer and for donations. Now, if you want to know anything further or you want to donate, then please feel free, see Amos or Bucky about that. I don't know whether there's anything out in the foyer or not, but certainly see Amos or Bucky if you want to know a bit more about the Warwick Gospel Choir there. They are all the notices, and they are in the will of the Lord. He said, hopefully, not missing anybody out. Okay, and then, yeah, it's another hymn. Music group, will you come and share with us? Can I ask a favour, please? You when you sing the last hymn, you said it's a good hymn. It's an old hymn. I can remember singing that. Yeah, okay. So not so much of the old.
It's all right, dear. So there you go. We're going to sing Who, O Lord, Could Save Themselves. This is the one we should have.
Thank you, folks. We're going to have our reading, and David Suchet is going to read for us. And if you want to follow that reading, it's in our Pew Bibles on page 1184, if you want to do that. Okay, thanks, Harry.
Colossians chapter 4. Masters, provide your slaves with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone.
It's a bit of a workout this morning, isn't it? Music group, yo. Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Anyway, do you good. And after this hymn, I'm going to ask Johnny to come and share with us, please. Thank you.
Enough for me. Christ is enough.
Let's pray, shall we? God, thank you for the words in that song. That if we believe it and we sing it with truth, that you are enough. That no matter what happens to us, no matter what situation or circumstance happens in our life, good or bad, that you are enough. And God, as we spend some time in your word, reflecting on your goodness, God, we thank you that we can sing those words. That in a world that is looking for meaning and looking for hope and looking for truth, God, we thank you that we can sing those words and hear that we have the hope, we have the truth, and we have Jesus. And he is enough. You are enough, Lord. Amen. Amen. It's so good to be here. It is so although I don't think my father and mother-in-law were involved in the decision of when preachers came, because the irony of me being invited to speak on this topic, Tim and Marion would have not approved. No, I'm joking. She's in the back. She's giving me stern looks. I'm joking. I've tempered everything. But if the truth's told, it's one of the verses that really excite me in the Bible. As a pastor, as a church leader, as a Christian, as a follower of Jesus, this verse, this one verse that we get to speak on this morning, be wise in the way that you act towards outsiders, making the most of every opportunity. It's one of the verses that really, really excite me and terrifies me and challenges me to my core. Got a few sayings that have kind of followed me in my life. One, never turn down a free buffet. You didn't have to laugh that much. The other one is, you don't know what you've done. And I remember, in fact, it probably started as a mischievous teenager, this kind of saying that seemed to follow me around my life, you don't know what you've done. In fact, I can probably picture my mum saying it to me. I broke something in the house by playing football inside when I shouldn't have done. You don't know what you've done. That was a Swarovski crystal that my grandma gave me. You don't know what you've done. And so what started as a horrific saying, in fact, it still fills me with the dread now just hearing it as a teenager. It's been redeemed over the years for me. As we look at this topic, you'll understand why. And I say this at the beginning before we start diving into anything, as a means of encouragement. You don't know what you've done. You don't know what you've done. As a younger person, I volunteered at MCYC, a summer camp that soaked many of our hearts here. And there was a group of lads at this camp. In fact, I think Alan Garner's grandson was one of them. Nephew, sorry, was one of them. And we put them to sleep. Not that sounded bad. We sent them to bed. And we were doing the night shift, and I'd walk around these tents, and you'd hear people chatting. And so I'd go in, and I'd tell these lads to shush, it's time to go to sleep. And then they started asking me lots of questions. It started off by asking loads of faith questions, and then it was about girls, and then it was about relationships, and you can see where the conversation was going to progress. And I remember at the time thinking, you lot are just trying to stay up. Like, you don't care about any of this kind of stuff. You're just saying it so that I'm going to chat to you for 45 minutes, and I'm going to tell you what I think, and we're going to have a conversation. But then the reality is you don't care about any of this kind of stuff. You just want to stay awake. And as the good youth leader, and if you get me talking about faith, it doesn't really stop. And so I dutifully had some big conversations with them over the case of 2 hours. It was 2 a.m. when we finished that conversation. And I remember going to bed going, done it, they're asleep, it's done. That was 10 years ago. Last year, I was speaking at a church, and one of the kids who's now not a kid, who's now a fully fledged adult, came and had a conversation with me and said, "Johnny, you have no idea how much that conversation impacted my life." And it changed the way I view relationships, it changed the way I view faith, and I've been on a real journey. I've been up and down and around, but I'm here, I'm in church. And I'm not saying it was because of that conversation, but that conversation had a huge part to play in my faith journey. So the conversation, I thought, was just so they could stay awake, and just because they were trying to get me to talk about sex, meant that actually what God was doing in that situation was wildly different to what I thought was happening. You don't know what you've done. You don't know what you've done. Your theme for the month is reaching out to a world in need, to a hurt, to a searching world. And today we deal with what Paul writes in verse 5 of this passage in Colossians. Be wise in the way that you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Be wise in the way that you act towards outsiders. We're going to split it into two halves. First half, be wise. The second half, make the most. But Paul was writing to this church to encourage them to be wise in their actions to the people outside of their community, their congregation. Now, I don't know what you think about the word wisdom. I don't know what springs to mind when you think that, but here's a definition of wisdom. The ability to use your knowledge and experience to make good decisions and judgments. Paul is encouraging us to use our knowledge and our experience to make good decisions and judgment when it comes to people who don't know Jesus. And I was reading various parts of the Bible as I prepared for this. And there's a story. We are not going to read the whole story because it's a massive chunk of text. But to give you a synopsis of the story, there's a story in John chapter 4 where Jesus meets a Samaritan woman at the well. And if you know enough about that situation, you'll know how countercultural this was. But I'll just give you a synopsis. While traveling through Samaria, Jesus stops at a well and he asks a Samaritan woman for a drink. Now, the woman, who was very surprised at this exchange, because there was a cultural divide between Jews and Samaritans. This was not, I always used to use the example of like Man United and Liverpool supporters. This, like, one of my best friends is a Man United supporter. This is like way, 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 way bigger than that cultural divide. But instead of lecturing her, this woman notifies Jesus, like, I'm a Samaritan, and I'm a woman. You shouldn't be speaking to me. Instead of lecturing her, Jesus responded with wisdom and compassion, offering a living water, symbolizing eternal life. And although she initially misunderstood, she got confused with what Jesus was saying, Jesus patiently guided her towards the truth. Through this approach, through what Jesus did in this exchange, he breaks some cultural barriers. He guides her to the truth with love and understanding, not condemnation. He doesn't rebuke her for not understanding. He doesn't tell her off. He doesn't speak down to her because she was of a different culture to him. Jesus' example of what it means to be wise with people who don't know faith is interesting because in another exchange, in John chapter 8, he stands up for injustice, and we see this rather fiery exchange that he has. Some religious leaders of the day. Now, religious leaders were trying to trip him up. They were trying to get him to say things that he ultimately was going to be crucified for. But he is strong and direct with these guys. He says, the famous verse is, he who is without sin should cast the first stone. So he's not just like all lovey-dovey, hippie. This is like real stand-up, straight-to-the-point stuff. He shows us the wisdom in the situation, circumstances. And we have them all the time in our daily lives. We have situations and circumstances where we can share our faith, where we can love the people, where we can show people who don't know Jesus what following Jesus is all about. And it's really funny, actually, because I don't fit The majority of the world out there, the majority of people who don't go to church, when I say that I'm a church pastor, they give me a bit of a look. In fact, I was getting my new phone on Friday, and I was in the Apple store, and I was picking up my new phone, and the guy was just making chit-chat with me. He's like, "Oh, so what do you do?" I was like, "Oh, I'm a church pastor." And he was like, "Really?" And I was a little bit offended at first. But people outside of the church, when they think of what a church vicar or pastor or minister looks like, I am not the fit, the 36-year-old guy with trainers and not a dog collar and all that kind of stuff. I don't fit into it. And I used to be really wary about it. In fact, I used to like tame it down a little bit. I used to, you know, without full disclosure of vulnerability here, one time, a long time ago, someone asked me what I did. I said I worked for a charity because I wasn't lying. But it could change the whole conversation. I remember people would like look at me in a weird way, or maybe not swear the next sentence, or maybe not like open up a little bit. And it could change the whole thing. But over time, I've lent into it. I've learned, I've grown, I've had some wisdom around these situations. I've experienced the times it's gone well, and I've experienced the times it's gone badly. But more importantly for me, I've spent more and more time getting to know Jesus, getting to know what he would do in that situation. And pretty much now, every time I get asked, "What do you do?" I lean into it and say, "I'm a pastor," and then I say a quick prayer in my head. "God, what would you have me say in this situation? What should I say? What should I do? How should I act?" That's because, not as a pastor, but as a follower of Jesus, every day, I want to know Jesus more. I want to become more like him. I want to do the things that he did. I want to act the way he acted. And that is a lifelong journey. And I'll be honest, even now it's difficult. Where Hope Church is, there's a couple of really nice coffee shops around. And I'm a bit of a coffee snob. And so I frequent quite a lot of these coffee shops around the church. And so, as you can imagine, with someone who drinks a lot of coffee and is going in every day, I get to know some of the team and some of the staff and some of the owners around. And I went into this local coffee shop over the road from our church. And just bearing in mind, it's the busiest week of like my year at the moment. I've just come back from sabbatical. We're about to launch a load of new stuff on Sunday. This is a couple of weeks ago. All of our kids' work is starting back up at church. Everything's chaos. And my life is insane. I just needed to go coffee. So I went over the road. I said, "Can I have a flat white, please?" And then I just said, "How are you?" to the person. And the guy launched into a verbal meltdown. He's having a really tough time. And amazingly, he felt like he could open up to me and say how rubbish his life was at that point. Do you know what my first thought? "Why now, God? I've got so much to do. I'm in a really bad mood. My kids have been doing my head this morning. I'm stressed to the eyeballs. Why on earth now?" But then I quickly prayed that prayer. "What should I do, God?" And so I said, "Do you want to grab a few minutes?" He said, "Yeah." We sat down for 30 minutes. I didn't say a word. I just listened. I just heard this meltdown after meltdown. I empathized with him. Said I was really sorry that he was going through what he was going through. And I said, "I'm going to pray for you." And then I said as well, "Our church has got a prayer WhatsApp group. We just kind of throw little things in every now and again. Would you mind? I can keep it anonymous. I don't have to tell you your name." And he was like, "Would you? Really?" He doesn't follow Jesus, this guy. I think I'm going to put into my job description as a pastor, and maybe even as a job description as a follower of Jesus, that we are meant to be interruptible. That the day and the moment that we have this moment of, if I'd have walked away from that, imagine what God might not have done in that situation. So I checked back with him a few days later. We had another coffee. We had another chat. And we are ongoing having a chat. It's a great excuse to go for coffee now. I don't need any other excuse. But wisdom is knowing the right way to act and behave towards people who don't know God. And this sets up the second part of our passage. Making the most of every opportunity. Opportunities to show God's love are often subtle. In the case of my friend in the coffee shop, it wasn't so subtle. He basically had a breakdown in front of me. But there's been times when I've come home from work and Bex is there, and Bex has said, or I've said to Bex, how are you doing? She's like, yeah, all right. And I've known, you kind of know, don't you, with your friends and family, you know when that's not quite strictly true. Making the most of every opportunity. It might be subtle, a conversation at work, the way you respond to someone when something hasn't gone to plan. I remember a friend who was a Christian, and he used to love winding people up on call centers. So they'd phone, you know when you get the cold calls, and he'd get really angry at them, and he'd just get really angry at them, and he'd escalate it, I want to speak to your supervisor. And I remember, again, fairly boldly as a 28-year-old going, is that really what Jesus would do? Is it? And so we play a game in our house. My kids play it now as well, which is great. And it probably talks to the fact that we go to McDonald's too much. But whenever we do the drive-thru or whenever we go into a store, the aim of the game is to make the cashier smile. And boy, the six-year-old Dan, he can pull some funny faces without a context, makes for a really interesting thing. But the aim of our moment there is to instill some joy to people. Instill some joy to people. It's a very small thing, but God is working when maybe we don't think he is. Again, just a little thing that I've started to do that makes a huge difference. And I encourage you, do it this week and watch the reaction. Whenever you finish a conversation with someone, you know them or not, say, I hope you have a great day today. As you walk away, just have a great day. Have a great day and watch people's reaction because they can't cope with it. People aren't used to people caring about each other, which tells us a lot about our world, doesn't it? When that is the abnormal thing. So every conversation you have, challenge number one. Good, bad, or indifferent. Imagine if you had a disagreement with someone or a complaint in a shop or something like that, and you finished the conversation with, that has been terrible and that's been a really bad situation, but I hope you have a great day. I mean it. Paul writes a big chunk of the New Testament, and there's a passage that he writes that encourages me, but hopefully I will never be in a situation to be encouraged in the exact same way. In Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 to 14, he writes this. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it's become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. He writes this from prison, which is why I hope it never happens to me in the exact way. But can you imagine going through the worst possible thing and your first reaction is, what can I do to expand the kingdom of God in this situation? Something that is so terrible that is happening to you. For him in chains. He didn't see prison as a setback, but as an opportunity to serve the gospel. Some opportunities will become really obvious. In 2020, when the COVID stuff hit, and we were going through that, 3 months into that, we had news that there were 100 asylum seekers being placed in a hotel. We pray that you would lead us, that you would guide us. God, that we would have that wisdom to know how to make the best and the most.
And I think if we stand and we say the grace together, ask the Lord to bless our week. Okay? I'd like to stand. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. God bless you. Johnny. Anytime.